zero pucks given.
Hello and welcome to Zero Pucks Given, the UK ice hockey podcast. We're in partnership with the Hockey Art Co, hockey clothing for hockey people, worn by the best and hated by the rest. Listeners to Zero Pucks Given get a 10% discount on everything site-wide at hockeyartclothing.co.uk. Just enter the code ZP10 upon checkout to get your discount. Make sure you check out the City series of products. I'm wearing the Toronto edition, so you can check one of them out there. We are also on the Sports Social Podcast Network. You can find all the episodes as well as a wealth of sporting podcasts from different sports from around the world on their website. This is episode 78. I'm Ben. Welcome along. We've got the match reports from an exciting weekend of league action and including a little bit of South Cup action as well. The exclusive coach's thoughts, player of the week, a look at the table and next week's fixtures. In the news then, we'll start with some DOPS updates. After Oxford's home defeat to MK last week, Darcy Flanagan surpassed the 10 penalty points threshold and receives two games. After the semi-final between Slough Jets and Jumpsuit Chieftains last week, for Slough, Harry Hatfield has received two games for fighting, third man in. For Chelmsford, Ollie Baldock receives two games for fighting, third man in. Ben Russell receives two games for fighting. Then Cameron Bartlett receives two for fighting and two for reaching 10 penalty points. Now for me, maybe my maths is wrong, but if Hatfield and Baldock were both third man in on the same incident, as well as I understand, was Ben Russell fighting himself? What about the incident caused the fight? So where's the ban there? There's these two game bans for fighting have got to be explained. Is fighting now a no-go? Is it out? Are England ice hockey trying to eradicate it from the game? The other issue there for me is that Cam Bartlett's suspension seems to have been attributed to the Saturday night fixture, but Cam's penalty and game ejection came on the Sunday, so it's all just a little bit still up in the air. And the fight on Sunday was retribution for a dangerous cross-check that was dangerous enough for the player to be ejected from the game, but not dangerous enough for further action. Again, no supporting video explanation behind the suspensions. Lewis Clifford remarked in his coach's thoughts from the weekend, as experienced as he is, he finds himself unaware of how the game is trending, where there seems to be a lack of accountability on the aggressor or instigator, and it appears the honour among competitors is dwindling. Now, I do apologise if that comes off as a bit biased. I will always do my best to be impartial. You should all know that by now. And I don't want to see players being suspended at all. As a fan, I still want to see it being physically competitive. So maybe it's not as much the officials as we all like to have a little dig at the stripes every now and again. But maybe it's what Cliff alludes to, a lack of honour in the modern game. Not for me to decide. What do you guys think? It's it's all about opinions. See what thing. Do you agree with the DOPS decisions? Do you agree with Cliff? Let me know. As I said, it's all about opinions. It's always good to have open conversations about the game we love. A little bit of roster news then. Petr Cech has made his way to the Belfast Giants again as the backup goalie after playing on Saturday night for Oxford City Stars. He's back off to Belfast. Once Flanagan returns from suspension, they'll then be able to use all three remaining imported skaters. And the Romford Buccaneers have bolstered their numbers by bringing back Leo Markey on a two-way from the Peterborough Phantoms. And he goes straight in for Saturday's home game against Slough Jets. We'll get to that game shortly. But of course, we start with the early face-off at Planet Ice in Gosport. The Streatham Redhawks in town, summoned by the Solent Devils for a sold-out game at the Devils Barn for the first time this season, I believe. The visitors were putting the early work in, although nearly gifting their host the lead, when Hops played off the boards and an unusual bounce took the puck behind Milton, heading for his goal, but Skokan was able to clear. The Devils had a power play chance early after Ryan Watt was called for slashing on 2:59, but Milton equal to everything, killed by the Redhawks. The visitors did take the lead, however, when Painter won a face-off straight to Jared Lane to snipe past Taylor for 1-0 on 7:25. Solon attempted to get going again when Callum Perella-Fox made a beeline for JJ Pitchley and both sat for five for fighting. Streatham were having the better of the chances, but Aaron Taylor was holding strong. The home side stole a pathway back into the game as the first was winding to an end when Peacock assisted Liam Coleman for a fantastic finish for 1-1 on 17:48. into the second, and it's a much more even affair. Hard battles all over the ice, but the visitors retook the lead when Beasley got the puck out from the boards to Sam Waller to score for 2-1 on 29-12. The Devils had a power play as Mason Wild celebrated his 200th Devils game. Congratulations to Mason by getting roughed up by Brandon Miles. Milesy sits for 2 on 30-20. Anthony Russell from Banners on the Wall was at this game and remarked how well drilled the Devils power play unit are. That will be music to the ears of last week's guest, Alex Murray. On 36-32, too many men called on Stretton Redhawks, followed by Sam Waller for interference, giving the Devils a period of 5-on-3. After the bench penalty is killed, the Devils fall foul of the same infraction and we have 20 seconds of 4-on-4, but no more goals. The third starts with the Devils having 45 seconds left to kill, which they do very well. A nervy start to the third saw another power play chance for Solent after Waller was called for holding in the 46th minute. But after the visitors returned to full strength, an offensive face-off for the Devils saw Osman set the puck back to Alex Murray, who sniped past Milton for 2-2 at 49-38. As the game was winding towards overtime, Benny Lee Newman forced a defensive error from Necrosivicius, steals the puck and scores past Taylor for 3-2 on 56-55. The final 3 minutes was obviously going to be an onslaught from the home side. Painter prepared his team for that. As the Devils pressed an interference call on Liam Coleman on 58-26, hampered the home side. Osman had a chance shorthanded before Taylor was pulled for the home side. And when the play broke down, Painter stepped in with the empty net goal to make it 4-2 to the Red Hawks. A bitter pill to swallow for the Devils, who worked their socks off against the league leaders, but unfortunately for them, in vain. Man of the match performances from Liam Coleman and Ziggy Beasley. For the Devils, it's a Sunday night trip to Chelmsford. For the Red Hawks, they will host the Thunder at the High Road. Saturday night at the Sapphire, the Buccaneers welcome the Jets off the back of a weekend off and the Jets making the cup final. The start of the game saw the Jets on the front foot, but they were on the penalty kill after Dreeland sat for two for hooking on 8:38 and found themselves then even-handed when Sam Austin sat for boarding on 9:06, but the Bucks killed that off. They were back on the penalty kill on 13:06 when Taylor sat for two for slashing, but despite best efforts, it remained 0-0. As the second got underway, Seb Moore and Joe Tamarlin found themselves taking a seat for roughing and hooking respectively on 20:29. Another set of penalties on both sides when Christian Moore and Jordan Liddell sat for two for roughing on 21:03. Further double penalties when Hildreth and Markey both sat for roughing on 22:28, three players each in the box. The Jets then took the lead when Seb Moore scored to make it 1-0 on 24:23. After that, the Jets won the power play again when Campbell sat for holding on 32:54. Bucks held strong, but when the Jets returned to full strength, they extended their lead when Rosamund Goodchild assisted Jacob Minter for 2-0 on 35-12. Further penalties for both sides after that, when Clark and Tamarlin both sat for 2+5 for holding and fighting and roughing and fighting respectively. The Jets then moved three goals ahead when Holliker assisted Seb Moore on 37-04. Straight from the restart, Sam Austin returned to the box for roughing on 37-09 before being joined by Jack Goodchild for hooking on 37-34. Then joined by Cathcart with a 10-minute misconduct penalty and an unnamed Bucks player for tripping on 38-50. Busy night for the officials in Romford. Into the third, and the penalty box benches were being warmed again when Timo Lindgren sat for two for holding on 44-46. The Jets killed off the penalty and then Markey went in for holding on 49-15. And this time the Jets made the Bucks pay when Holliker and Redmond assisted the returning Timo Lindgren for 4-0 on 51-01 power play goal. Christian Moore took a seat for cross-checking on 54-31, but after the Jets returned to full strength, the Bucks pulled one back when Wakeling assisted Nathan Long for 4-1 on 56-44. On 58-58, the Bucks made it an uncomfortable last minute for Slough when Wakeling assisted Tom Wilson for 4-2 with a minute and two remaining. As they pushed, Taylor took two for slashing on 59-21, making it very hard for the home side to press. So 4-2 it stayed. A solid road win for the Slough Jets. Didn't catch the man of the match for them. Nathan Long takes it for the Bucks. After the game, Buccaneers head coach Jason Buckman gave his thoughts to ZPG.
Yeah, I thought it was a competitive game of hockey against Slough. We had plenty of chances early in the game, but wasn't clinical enough. You know, to go from scoring 7 goals away in Invicta to struggle for 50 minutes against Slough was tough going. Their goalie, you know, definitely had a good game, but I think the guys understand they need to be more clinical. You know, overall, it was a close game. It could have gone more our way. Had a few calls gone for us, but that's hockey. Slough play away, which suits them, and you could probably argue suits the way games are officiated now. But it is what it is. Doesn't really change any league positions too much. But felt the guys learnt a little bit more this weekend with a view to adjust and go into next weekend's fixture against Slough.
The final game of Saturday night saw the Oxford City Stars rather shorter bench than they would have liked. And with just 59 seconds on the clock, they found themselves behind at the Dynamos when Brandon Chard went unassisted for 1-0. Chard turned provider on 11-12 when he assisted Ollie Bronniman to make it 2-0. Chances at both ends saw the Stars ding the iron and Petr Cech justify his selection as the first ended 2-2. Into the second, and the Stars took a bench penalty for too many men on 28-26, and the home side made them pay as Steno Laszczyk from behind the goal put the puck in off Petr Cech's back for 3-0 on 28-53, power play goal. The Mohs then had to kill a laming slashing penalty on 31-32, doing so successfully. Into the third, and Oxford took an early timeout that seemed to signify some more physical play as Oliver and Stevens have a tilt after a big hit on the boards. Oliver gets 5 for fighting, Steven gets 5 for fighting, 5 for boarding, and plus game for misconduct. I'm sure we'll hear more about that at 10 p.m. on Friday. The Mohs extended their lead to 4-0 when Scott and Dell assisted Stano Laszczyk on 50-55, power play goal. And after the Stars returned to full strength, Matty Bell went unassisted to make it 5-0 to the Dynamos on 58-21. A shutout for Ryder, credit to the short bench Stars for making Invicta work for their result, as both teams head back to the Oxpens for a South Cup clash on Sunday. Matt Friend starting in nets for the Dynamos as the crowd start to fill the Oxford Ice Arena, doing incredible ticket sales this season. But it was just like deja vu as 47 seconds into the game, Ruskin Springer-Hughes went unassisted to make it 1-0 to the Mohs. The visitors killed off a Matty Bell holding penalty on 11:55, and as the period was heading for a tight finish, Springer-Hughes and Laszczyk assisted Tom Saw on 19:33 for 2-0. Into the second, and the Stars bit back at the Mohs when Lauder assisted Jake Williams for his first goal since returning on 21-28. However, a few minutes later, Invicta stretched their lead when Laszczyk and Springer-Hughes assisted Tom Saw to make it 3-1 on 26-53. The Stars made it a one-goal game again when Lauder and Pentecost assisted Dylan Hullaby for 3-2 on 28-02. However, from the restart, the Mohs pushed further ahead when Laszczyk assisted Tom Saw for his hat-trick on 28-52 for 4-2. Dell and Ravenscroft have a disagreement on 31-38, seeing them both sit for 5 before Laszczyk nailed another assist with Saw, this time for Ruskin Springer-Hughes to grab his second of the night on 34-29 for 5-2. As the teams came out for the third, Carl Lennon's words still ringing in their ears, the Mohs pulled further away when Bell and Dell assisted Mads Thune, making it 6-2 on 41-37. It was made a little uncomfortable when Elliott and Bundock assisted Jake Williams for his second on 47-04, before the Stars had the puck in the net again, but it was waved off by the officials. A few penalties for both sides after some scuffles saw Oliver get 2 for roughing, Stedman get 2+2 for roughing and boarding, and the Stars saw Elliott and Mitchell both get 2 for roughing. Back at full strength, and the Stars made Invicta's night a little more nervy as Harding and Hullaby assisted Ben Nethersell for 6-4 on 54-26. A few more penalties as the Mohs briefly have a 5-on-3, even after a 5-minute major for boarding for Elliott, no further goals. A 6-4 road win for the Invicta Dynamos, another blank weekend for Oxford. A huge congratulations to Owen Dell for passing 100 points and Stano Laszczyk for passing 200 points for the Dynamos. After the game, Mohs head coach Carl Lennon gave his thoughts to ZPG.
We had a doubleheader this weekend with Oxford. On Saturday, we were at home in the league, and then on Sunday, we played away in the cup. And I thought across the weekend, we were the stronger of the two sides and were pretty deserving of our 4 points across the two different competitions. Saturday, I thought we dominated large spells of the game, and were it not for us being wasteful of some of our scoring chances, the score might have even been higher still. We came up against the goalie that put in a man of the match performance in check, and you know, I think were it not for maybe better shot selection and attacking play, then we might have been a little bit more dominant in that capacity. What I was happy with was how we managed the game defensively. We were very strong in our zone and limited their scoring chances. And, you know, duly, credit goes to Owen for his shutout in that performance. Then Sunday was a little different proposition. They welcomed a few players back to their lineup, and we were obviously fishing for that win in the cup. I was glad that in a place where, you know, a lot of teams have struggled to get good results at times this season, we were able to get the job done and to get those points. It was a story almost the opposite of the day before, where I actually thought we were quite clinical, quite ruthless with our finishing, and took the opportunities as and when they came to us. But we sort of made some casual errors which invited pressure and turnovers, and ultimately resulted in us conceding those four goals, which I don't think we really needed to pull ourselves into in the evening. Matt Friend was excellent in goal, and there were moments where he stood on his head and really helped us out massively. So I think all in all, you know, good to get 2 points in each of the competitions and, you know, get ourselves back on track and back to winning ways. This weekend is a different proposition. Two games this weekend in the cup and second cup competition, and we need, you know, a good result in both of those games in order to keep ourselves in contention of that competition. So we've got two different teams in Chelmsford and Streatham. We've played Streatham a lot recently, so we know what they'll bring to the table. Chelmsford will be a slightly different proposition from what we encountered earlier before Christmas, I think it was now, the last time we played. So we look forward to that, and look forward to getting back on the ice this week. Cheers.
Sunday night at the High Road saw the MK Thunder arrive with pretty much the same team that arrived at Chelmsford, rather than the team that went to Oxford and came away with 2 points. And it took all of 18 seconds for the league leaders to flex their muscles when Beasley and Brittle assisted Jared Lane for 1-0. Shortly after, the Redhawks doubled their advantage when Watt and Ben Ely Newman assisted Jared Lane for his second for 2-0. And on 3-flat, it was 3-0 when Painter and Miles assisted JJ Pitchley. Streatham's captain kept up his scoring form since his return when Skokan assisted Ryan Watt to make it 4-0 on 6-11. On 7-flat, McCluskey took a 2-minute penalty for delay of game, but Norton held strong for MK. A little break from the goals until Brittle assisted Ben Painter to make it 5-0 on 14-24, and the first was rounded off when Painter and Miles assisted JJ Pitchley for his second for 6-0 on 18-10. Dan Norton in the MK net, the only reason this one is this close. Into the second, and Dylan Phillips, now in the Redhawks net, sees his side have an early power play chance when Hagger sat for tripping on 20-31, but the Thunder killed it off. On 23-57, Ryan Watt added his second goal on the rebound from his own Michigan attempt, assisted by Lane and Burnett for 7-0. And from the restart, Miles assisted Ziggy Beasley for his second of the game for 8-0 on 24-52. Miles and Pitchley assisted Ben Painter for his second to make it 9-0 on 28-18. Straight from the face-off, double figures was achieved when Ryan Watt bagged his hat-trick, assisted by Lane on 28-30. There seems to be a goal missing from the Streatham feed, but still kudos to Chris Beale. It's incredibly hard to keep up with a game like this, doing play-by-play and all the goals, but 11-0 at the end of the second. Into the third, and the Redhawks killed off an early Brandon Miles penalty before the Thunder pulled one back on the breakaway when Davis and Hagger assisted Barrow on 49-04. Streatham moved further ahead when Watt assisted Ziggy Beasley for his hat-trick for 12-1 on 52-37. JJ Pitchley got his hat-trick on 55-16, assisted by Burnett and Miles, 13-1, before the scoring was finished by Ben Ely Newman, assisted by Lane and Brittle on 57-59. A 14-1 win, a four-point weekend for the league leaders. Man of the Match awards to Jared Lane and Mario Chiru. After the game, Streatham player coach Ben Painter gave his thoughts to ZPG.
Yeah, obviously we went to Solent on the Saturday, and everyone knows it's a very difficult place to play. Obviously with the rink, it's not easy, but on top of that, you're playing against a team that they all battle. They're very, very sort of structured, and Alex has got them to a place where they compete every night, no matter what, and you go there knowing you're in for a night. It's never easy. So I was extremely pleased with how we started the game. I think we came out on the front foot, we were on our toes, and it's always hard to get going there, and a lot of times teams go down early, but yeah, I think we dominated the early part of the game, and we probably could have been a couple of goals up if we were just a little bit more clinical or had some bounces fall for us a little bit nicer. We could have scored a couple early on that would have really set us up, but we didn't. But at the end of the day, like we kept going, we battled, and I imagine from a spectator's point of view, it was a good game of hockey to watch, and I think it was very end to end. And at 2-1, you could feel there was a goal coming, and I don't think you really knew where it was coming from. I think everyone that was there, we had a short bench, but everyone bought in, everyone played well, everyone sort of battled and done what they needed to do and what I asked of them. And again, Milts, I say it every week, but Milts stood in his head and made some key saves for us, and it was good to see. I mean, they tied it up late to make it 2-2, and I think at that point, that's when we turned it up again. It maybe woke us up a little bit, and I think from my point of view, it's great to see that, you know what, when our back's up against the walls, we really do dig our heels in and dig deep. And I mean, there's a little bit of controversy around the third goal, whether it was offside or not. Haven't seen the video, so can't really comment. But I think either way, like, if it was offside, then for me, like, we don't get much luck. We don't get many bounces, and we don't get sort of that luck much. So if it was, I think that's a bit of a reward for how hard we worked, and especially over the last couple of weeks and even the last couple of months, we've been really sort of digging deep with a lot of injuries and things like that. So that may be just a little bit of a reward there to just rewarding our efforts over the last few weeks. But I take nothing away from it. Benny Newman, one-on-one with a goalie, played a great move. And yeah, he put the puck in the net, and it was a great finish. And he comes up clutch for us all the time. So yeah, I was extremely pleased. And obviously we scored an empty net to seal it off there. But I was extremely pleased with how we performed. Everyone battled and dug deep and did what they had to do to get 2 points. And then, yeah, we go into Sunday against MK Thunder, 14-1 or 15-1, whatever it was. Firstly, I want to take my hat off to the players that turned up, and they turned up with 11 skaters and one goalie. It's a joke, to be honest. I feel sorry for the players. They emptied their tanks. They work so hard all night. Like, they never give up, and they're playing for the goalie. The goalie's playing for them. And yeah, like, the guys that do turn up, you take your hat off to them. It's never an easy game to play in when it's like that. And I don't think anyone really wants to be playing in games like that. No one wants to watch games like that. And I think it's wrong, to be honest. I don't think it's right. Everyone sort of harps on about us going up, but Chelmsford put 17 by them last week as well. So it's one of them. We need to, it's a difficult one. I guess it's not really my place to say, but I mean, I take my hat off to their players. Like, they battled all night, and they really did sort of give their all. And yeah, for my guys, like, I think we handled ourselves professionally. We went about things the right way. I'm really sort of really pleased how we conducted ourselves. We had some great composure on the park, and we had a lot of time on the park, and yeah, we made some nice plays, but we stuck to our sort of systems, and I asked the guys to make sure we're sticking to our systems and things like that, and we did. And yeah, I was pleased with our weekend. It was a really good weekend of hockey, and I mean, four more points on the board, and we're chugging away nicely here, and I'm pleased with how we've been going here. We just keep going.
The Riverside in Chelmsford saw the Solent Devils make the long trip from the south coast. Steve Osman and Liam Coleman only arriving after the doors had opened, but the Devils were game from the very first buzzer. Potent coming forward and incredibly hard to break down. The home side had a power play chance when Harry Cloutman sat for two for tripping on 6:25, but the Devils held very firm. They had a chance themselves when Rayner sat for two for boarding. Steve Osman was up for retribution, however Rayner protested the accidental nature of his infringement and tempers were calmed. Chieftains had another power play chance when Callum Perella-Fox got two for tripping on 15:52, and immediately after the penalty, Jameson playing as a forward and Grant Bartlett assisted Damon Porter to make it 1-0 to Chelmsford on 17:58. As the period was nearing an end, Necro Savicius found Liam Coleman unmanned in the slot, and he smashed past Lauday to make it 1-1 on 19:32. Into the second, and the Devils seemed to set up as if on the power play with a very menacing square formed around the Chiefs' defensive zone, and took the lead when the puck bounced out to Alex Murray, who flung it goalwards from the half boards where Steve Osman was there to tip in from close range for 2-1 on 23:29. The Chieftains had to kill a period of 5-on-3 when Hitchings and Rayner sat consecutively for tripping and roughing. I can confirm Anthony Russell's observation that Solent are incredibly well drilled on the power play, but Lauday equal to everything through the penalty period. However, when the game was again even-handed, the Devils extended their lead when Alex Murray and Drew Campbell assisted Liam Coleman for his second with a close-range finish for 3-1 on 31-02. Soon after, the visitors extended their lead further when the late arriving pair made it 4, Liam Coleman assisting Steve Osmond for his second. A collision in an offensive face-off for Chelmsford saw Steve Osmond go down hard and leave the ice. Best wishes for speedy recovery for Ozzy. With 3 minutes to go, the Chieftains had the puck on the goal line in a bit of a scramble, but with the net off and a melee in the crease, the score remained the same. Into the third, and the home side fell foul of an injury as a mid-ice collision saw Jay King leave the ice. The Chieftains then had a power play chance where Mason Wild sat for two for tripping on 46-32. And the home side thought they'd got back into the game, but netminder interference was called and the goal was chalked off. Before the restart, Charlie Wedge was given two for delay of game, giving the Chieftains a 5-on-3 chance, which they took when Jameson and Barnes Garner assisted Damon Porter for his second on 48-26 power play goal. At this point, Jay King had returned to the ice and the Chieftains got another power play chance when Necro Vicious sat for two for boarding on 52-20. But the well-drilled Devils again held strong and the game swung hard to the visitors when Jay King had a 2-minute penalty for boarding up to a 5-minute major on 55-23. The Chieftains almost had a shorty on the breakaway and then Calaparella Fox got two for hooking on 58-07, forcing the Chieftains into going empty net. As the Devils broke away, the first attempt from Coleman was missed, but from behind the goal, he picked out Chris Necrosivicius to hit the empty net for 5-2 on 58-30. From the restart and with Lorde back in the net, Hitchings and Fay worked the puck for Grant Bartlett, who managed to tuck the puck home for 5-3 on 58-55. That was how it finished. In all honesty, a scoreline that flattered the home side, who never really got going. Murray's boys on it from the start, looking to put right what had gone wrong the night before. After the game, Solent player coach Alex Murray gave his thoughts to ZPG.
Following the results on the weekend, there's obviously some mixed feelings there. I think Saturday at home at Streatham, we really felt that we owed those guys a performance. You know, that if we played well enough, we'd be able to get something out of the game. And I think we played a hell of a game. We stayed with it. Obviously, they got the lead and we pulled it back. And then the second, we had a lot of power play time. I think that was the difference, if I'm being honest, in the game. You can't have prolonged power plays, especially a 5-on-3, and not capitalise against the top team in the league. We didn't. Danny Milton stood on his head. Then we outshot them a lot in that second and parts of the third. Going into the third, 2-1 down was tough, but we were playing well and we got that game-tying goal. A lot's been said, you know, about their third goal. Still haven't quite seen the video, but I'm pretty confident that it was offside, speaking to my team. And that's a tough pill to swallow, and accept, you know, working so hard to get a result against the top team in the league and they score a goal that there's question marks around is difficult. But look, we kept pushing to the end. Obviously, we pulled the goalie and they scored an empty net. But I was happy with the performance. Just frustration at the end there to lose in that manner. But look, the guys showed great resilience, showed great, you know, bounce back to go into Chelmsford the night after. We're missing again a lot of key guys, no Pitts, no Coley, no Lackey. And we called up a lot of the younger two-way guys, and going 1-0 down there could have gone a lot of different ways. But, you know, again, we fought back. We showed our maturity, played a great second period. Took a 4-1 lead, never really looked back. And even though there was some penalty trouble in terms of injuries, you know, we lost two guys to head injuries in the game, you know, where we're going to have to look at, I think, as a club and what those hits were like. The next guy up mentality, you know, came through there and we really showed our character and saw that game through. And I'm delighted with the 2 points against Chelmsford. Realistically, I feel like we probably deserve more points over the weekend, but you know, we're gearing ourselves up for a playoff run here and we've got to make sure every team's aware of what we're capable of.
Another cracking weekend of ice hockey in the NHL 1 South, truly one of the most competitive leagues in the country. All starting to take shape for the playoffs now as teams are looking around the table, wondering who to avoid. Well then, after all the games, let's do this then.
It's Justin Wong, Kenny Wu from the Muddy Ducks, presenting Zero Pucks Given Britain Division Player of the Week.
Player of the week this week. Some great performances, particularly from Invicta and Streatham, Laschek, Saw and Lane, all with great weekends. But Also with a four-point weekend and on the back of some brilliant form for the Streatham Red Hawks, this week's Zero Pucks Given Player of the Week is Ziggy Beasley.
Ziggy played guitar, jamming good with Webb and Gilly and the spiders from Mars.
The table then, the Britain Division table. The order doth change too much, but gaps are closing and also appearing. Top to bottom then, in at the top, at number one, the Streatham Red Hawks. Play 22, 119, lost 3, 38 points. In second place, the Slough Jets played more than anyone. 26 games, just 2 league games left for them. 118, lost 8, 36 points. In third, the Chelmsford Chieftains with just 4 league games to go. Played 24, 116, lost 8, 32 points. And the top four completed by Solent Devils. Played 22, 113, lost 8, with 1 OT loss, 27 points. After their league win Saturday, the Invicta Dynamos are in fifth still with 23 games played, 112, lost 8, and 3 OT losses, 27 points. Then a bit of a gap to Romford Buccaneers, played 20, 1-7, lost 11, 2 OT losses, and 16 points. Then another wee gap down to Oxford City Stars in seventh, played 24, 1-3, lost 19, 2 OT losses, 8 points. And finally in eighth, played 19, 1-2, lost 17, 4 points. Fixtures for next week then. Saturday night sees a full programme as the Solent Devils head to the Sapphire to face the Romford Buccaneers at 5:15. The Riverside sees Saturday night South Cup hockey as the Chelmsford Chieftains host the Invicta Dynamos at 5:30. Also 5:30 on the high road in SW16 as the Streatham Red Hawks face Slough Jets. Top two in the league go head-to-head. And at 7 p.m, the Thunderdome is the venue for MK Thunder versus Oxford City Stars. Sunday night sees the Red Hawks head to the stables to face Invicta in the South Cup at 5:45 p.m. The City Stars host the Chieftains in the South Cup at 6:15. And the Slough Jets host the Romford Buccaneers in the league at the Hangar for a 6:30 p.m. face-off. Right, well, episode 78 is in the bank. Another cracking weekend of hockey. High drama everywhere. A little later this week, I'll be catching up with MK Thunder's 21-year-old Romanian forward, Mario Ciru. So make sure you follow all the socials and do not miss that. Please subscribe on the YouTube, on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, so you never miss an episode. Thank you to all the coaches for sending in their coaches' thoughts. And thank you so much for listening. I will see you next time.